next item on the agenda. We're looking at the home screening. Can we have a guarantee from the cabinet member, isolating, we're all pretty inactive campaigns that we're off, but can we have a guarantee from the cabinet member that all property owners identified as being liable for this service will be contacted by the authority and made aware of this and offered assistance to bring their properties back into use or put on the market, rather than just hitting the bit 2% of the business interest?
Apologies, I don't know the time. Yeah, I mean, it is an issue which I've been, working on for quite a while now, Councillor Lewis. We do have a number of debtors within this bracket who simply don't pay because they don't think we should back the meter on them because, you know, it's a debt that's going to the council and therefore to go to pay all the debts. Of course, if there are certain circumstances, as I said before, then we can help. But I think working with my colleague Stuart, who has got a wide strategy around empty homes to bring them back into use. So thanks for the question. Apologies to the Chamber for jumping the gun. I'll get the next item as well.
Seconder of the motion, Councillor Hackett. You have 3 minutes if you wish.
I do wish to second. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, thank you.
Right, proposer of the motion, Councillor Williamson. Want to write your reply? No? Okay. Right, there be no further comments. We will now move to the vote and the first electronic voting of the evening. So, it's all ready.
Right, open to debate. Have you got any speakers? And you will have up to 3 minutes.
Close the vote. Yes, thank you. Right, votes in favour 55, votes against 0, abstentions 1. So that's the parrot, I should have said that one first. Right, 9E. This is a referral from the Cabinet meeting held on the 25th of November 2019. Can I call Councillor Jeanette Williamson to move the recommendations detailed on the agenda? Councillor Pat Hackett, second.
Second, Mr. Mayor.
Right, proposer of the motion, again.
No.
Thank you. Now we're opening that to debate. Have you got any speakers? And you have up to 3 minutes to address the Council. Right. Councillor Phil Gilchrist.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think members will have read the papers, and the issue that comes back year after year is that there can be slippage, there can be schemes that fall behind, there can be schemes that aren't prepared and ready to move, and there can be schemes that things go wrong with. But the gap between what the Council puts forward as its capital programme year, in this case £90 million, what the forecast is, £52 million, seems quite substantial. Perhaps you can assure us that each year when the Council discusses its capital programme, we are in a situation where schemes can move and that it can be monitored and completed in the envisaged time scales.
Thank you.
I'd like to ask you, Chris. Yeah, currently overhauling the capital programme process anyway, I felt strongly that it needs to look at it again. I don't think it's member-led enough, so we're currently rewriting the capital programme policies and procedures which will come involve this chamber a lot more, and that would be part of it, about setting our goals at realistic goals and whether or not what smart capital can be released for other things. So take that point on board, absolutely.
Thank you. No further speakers. We now move to the vote. Electronic voting again. Yes, ready. Voting now. Everyone voted. Votes in favour 56. Votes against 0. Abstentions 1. So that's been carried. Okay, we move on to 9F. Minimum. This is a referral from the Cabinet meeting held on the 25th of November 2019. Calling Councillor Jeanette Williamson to move the recommendations detailed on the agenda. Councillor Hackett, second.
Second,
Mr. Mayor. Right. Again, no. Okay. Right, debate now. Are there any speakers who wish to? No. Seconder of the motion, Councillor Hackett. 3 minutes, no? Okay, thank you. Right of reply, Councillor Williamson. No, again. Be no further speakers. We again move to the vote. I'm voting. Are you ready? Yes, voting now. Right, votes in favour 58, votes against 0, abstentions 1, so that's been carried. Item 9G, this is a referral from the Licensing Act 2003 committee meeting held on the 13th of November 2019. So now calling Councillor Andrew Hodgson to move the recommendations detailed on the agenda. Thank you. I call on Councillor Paul Stewart to second.
Councillor Stewart's absence, I'd like to second.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Austin, you now have up to 5 minutes to speak to your motion, so wish.
Just a few seconds, it won't take long. Removing this, which includes the standards of licensing and also the cumulative impact assessment policy to the area of Burke and Hare, this will be a useful tool for the police who are trying to keep the street drinking and the anti-social behaviour in Burke.
be back on this, why public health is not a consideration anymore. Councillor McGoughan as well. So it's back on this, why public health is not a consideration.
Back to Councillor Jones, proposer of the motion. You have 3 minutes to reply. Right. If you have no further comments, we now move to electronic voting. Okay? Ready? Vote now. Right, votes in favour 58, votes against 0, abstentions 1. So that has been carried. Thank you. Right, we're now going to ask the Chief Executive to return, and he is going to make a presentation to the full council.
First of all, thank you very much, everybody, for the tremendous honour of being asked to be Chief Executive of this council. It'll be a really exciting time for us all. For those that do know me, I've been on a bit of a journey in the last few years of my career. I don't take being asked to be Chief Executive lightly. I do consider it to be an absolute honour and a pleasure and a privilege, and I do understand the decision that E&A took, which was quite unique in terms of deciding to just appoint me without going through any further process. I do thank you all. As I said, it is really exciting time that we face in the Lord Council, some very challenging times too, but together I'm sure that we can get through this period. One of the tasks that E&A asked me to do the last E&A was go back and set out my vision, and certain members of the E&A committee thought it would be a good idea to bring that presentation here to share with full council, which I'm absolutely delighted to do. So, as you know, since June 2019, I've been interim chief executive, and these are some of my reflections of the council as an organisation. First of all, we need to break and make the culture. We need to move away from the rules away. We shouldn't underestimate the challenge of that. This is a big oil tanker that we need to turn around, and it is going to take some time, but I believe that we can do that. As an individual, at a service and at a partnership level, there is much improvement to be had. So I've heard the debates today, although somewhat muted, over the streetlights and around how we deliver services, how we work with our partners. And I hope you have seen some progress since June, but there is still an awful lot of work to do. The evidence is there, there are some green shoots, you will have seen Wirral Waters, you will have seen the Keep Moat development. You haven't been part of the conversations that myself and Alan Ames have been having with MHCLG over the local plan. I've been talking to the NHS, we've been talking to the universities, all who have a stake in the council and in the borough, and we are making progress. Customers is a horrible word, because in a council it is a catch-all phrase, so residents, members, stakeholders, another whole word, businesses, partners, the combined authority. But they need to be the heart of what we do. the centre of our ambition. We cannot work without them being at the centre of what we're doing. One of the things, many of you heard me say this, I was not an expert on regeneration growth or the local plan at the start of the year. All became apparent really early in January, February time, was businesses expect to see the chief executive. The MDs of these companies, the MD of Peel, expects and have dialogue with the chief executive. And so we need to work at that level. It's never going to be easy, but we have to, and I have to lead the organisation through that. We need to tackle the causes in the organisation as well as the symptoms. We need systematic change. That's not major transformation programmes, that's not massive spin-outs. That's getting things right first time and changing the culture and the way in which we act. We need a long-term fundamental programme of fixing things and getting things right. And we need to transform in parallel. But what we don't want is people doing this to us. We need to do this ourselves. Much as I need to change the culture of the organisation, there is an awful lot of talent in the organisation that we need to move forward and we need to develop. Again, for those who've been part of the ENA committee most recently, we've stopped using external recruitment agency where we can. We are developing our own talent. That's not to say we won't be moving people into the organisation that have those skills, but we need to recognise some of the talent that we do have and celebrate it. We've got to create the right conditions for good and outstanding services. It is no longer acceptable that we'll just get by. And that's about me leading the organisation, that's about my senior leadership team leading this organisation, taking this really seriously. What's the strategic planning framework? What are we trying to achieve? I don't believe we have that, and then it's really difficult to convey that message to staff, who I think need to understand what we're here to do, and I'll talk to you a little bit in a minute about the vision. We haven't made best use of our resources, so we don't make sure they're efficiently and effectively deployed, and as most of you know, we've used consultants and external companies where perhaps we could have done that ourselves. You would have seen a decline in the number of interims, you would have seen a decline in the number of consultants we use. That's not to say we won't need to use them, because we will need specialist help, but we don't need to rely on them. We rely less on them, we develop our own workforce, and we give our workforce those skills and that confidence. We've got to sort, we've got to disrupt, we've got to create a space to drive change. So we've got to challenge behaviours. I use the example of the member of the Sunday Parade back a few Sundays ago at Birkenhead. Really, really proud to be there, clearly valued by the civic community. But the number of people laying wreaths from me and leading to the mayor almost went back to the door in the town hall. We've layered and layered and layered and layered things on rather than actually looking at how we're doing things and how can we improve things day by day, week by week. And the impact of that was poor Piper was still piping half an hour in and he nearly suffocated and he couldn't get his breath anymore. Let's look at how we do things, let's reflect, let's change, and let's make small improvements as we go along. So my eyesight is not that good, I can't read that. So on the 14th of October we set out, so you agreed, the council plan for 2025. A lot more simple than the previous one. It sets out a vision for Wirral, for our workforce and what we're trying to achieve. I'm not a fan of strap lines and mission statements, but it's also important to our staff know why what they're here to do. We set out some key values. What is it we expect from a public servant? Because if our staff don't recognise they're here to work for you and to work for the benefit of the residents of the community, they're probably in the wrong organisation. We've got five key priorities we want to achieve by 2025. Nothing fancy, but some really simple things that we can do and we can achieve. And we also set out what we would achieve in this year. So the vision for 2025 for the authority and for the particularly for staff, is that we are here as officers to secure the best future for our residents. They have to be inspired to achieve community prosperity, and we need to provide excellent services through our excellent people. I believe over the last few years we've lost sight of why we as officers are here. And again, hearing the stories that I hear, and I believe you may, I see all your correspondence over the street lights and around the potholes, and how we respond to you, and we definitely need to improve that. Because if I can do that for you, you will allow me to do the big and exciting things. Because we need to get that right, and we need to get our residents on board, and then we can do all the exciting stuff that we're all here to do, about seriously creating a community in a borough that we are all proud of. So our priorities have to be, we need a prosperous and inclusive economy, where local people can get good jobs and fulfil their aspirations, where visitors can experience a destination that is rich in culture and experience. I was part of bringing the tour of Britain here in September, which was a great success. But you only had to look at the social media up until the day it came, where nobody believed he was coming here. Everybody thought we'd done it because we're going to resurface the roads, and why would they come here? And I've never known a community where we don't believe we can do it, but we can. Afterwards, for those that don't know, and this was indicative of all the events we did this year, people were so proud. The organisers of the Tour of Britain said it was the best stage of the year. They went around corners that the week before, because they drive the course the week before, that they thought there'd be nobody there, and people were 3 or 4 deep. It was live television coverage for 5 hours, and everybody's asking us, when is it coming back? Once we do it, people can see we can do it, but pulling the neck, when we do it, we do it really well. The riders loved it, the organisers loved it, and that's an example of what everything that we do when we put our minds to it, and that's what we need to do. We need a sustainable borough. We have to address the challenges around the environment and climate change. I believe we have to lead that on behalf of the community. One of the things that I am coming very quickly to conclusion, and this is around health and everything else, is that our NHS colleagues are looking to us to lead as the local authority. And if we don't take that lead, nobody else is going to do it. Doesn't mean so we have to do it for everybody, but we have to facilitate that and start to make that happen. It's really important we create brighter futures for our young people. We have a great opportunity with the amount of brownfield site that we have, with the opportunity we now have with the local plan, to create a community in a borough that doesn't meet our needs, meets the needs of the generation behind us and behind us and behind them. And when you start to talk to them and you ask them, do you want to design a borough? Yes, they do. Do they want to influence the type of materials and the type of buildings we build? Yes, they do. And we have a really great opportunity because from adversity in the local plan at the start of the year to where we are now, we're under no doubt this will shape the borough for the next 10 to 15 years. From that, we can create safe and vibrant communities where people want to live and raise their families. And we'll provide services which help people live happy, healthy and active lives. But we have to change that model because we can't afford to do it all anymore for all the community. Some may argue that we never did it well in the first place. And part of our job is to facilitate that, to get the communities working, to get the third sector working, to get the voluntary sector working. And yes, to use the private sector where appropriate, but working with the private sector as equal partners. My early conversations with Peel, which was the same with the Combined Authority, which was the same with MHCLG, was our goals were too wide. We had open goals because we didn't do this and didn't do that. Over the last 12 months, we've tightened those up so we have equal playing field conversations now with these people, which we never had before. So when Peel push back and say we haven't done something, I can say, yes we have, you haven't done X, Y and Z. And you can see the difference now, because you can see what's down on the road. So together, and I can't do this on my own, I need my senior leadership team, I need the workforce, and I need you to help me. We're going to need a comprehensive organisation change programme, which will create a new operating model for the council. That sounds really fancy, but what that will give you is clear line of sight of officers with very simple job titles, with contact numbers, with email addresses, so you can get hold of them. You just need to bear with me for a little while I get that sorted out. But we will have a new model which enables us then to interact better with our communities and with the NHS. And we talked earlier about public health, around public health more, having more of a central role in the organisation. We'll create the right environment to support cultural change with consistent delivery and improved communication. How do we communicate better to the communities that we serve? How do we communicate better with you? And how do we communicate better with our 330,000 residents? We've got to work to create a sound financial platform. And that's going to be tough over the next year or so. We're doing a lot of work, particularly Cher and I, to get us into that position. We perhaps haven't got the luxury of time, but perhaps we would have had it 5 years ago. But once we get there, we need to ensure that we perform well and we sustain it. We need to deliver a stronger focus on the customer, providing you with the service that you expect from us. And one of the things I've said to staff is that for members, read shareholders or non-executive directors. Nikki Butterworth, our acting director of delivery, is currently running an intensive programme with her staff over customer, putting themselves on the customer's shoes. And many of you will have heard me tell the tale of when I came to Labour Group in the summer, driving on the A41 with David Armstrong a couple of miles behind me. There was an old mattress on the side of the road and a bit of grass. That mattress wasn't our mattress, the grass wasn't our grass. But to the residents and to you, that was the council's responsibility. So phone David Armstrong, and of course, as you expect with David, we got it moved. I need the eyes and ears of the borough to be staff that phone up and tell me there's a problem before you tell me. Well, hopefully they don't tell me, we get it sorted. But the point of last resort is you have to tell me there's a problem and we need to get it fixed. I stood in a building in the summer. I couldn't get into the building, so I was made to wait in the waiting room. Somebody who knew me walked past, didn't let me in, didn't walk me upstairs. I did then say, do you not know who I am, I'm going to check it. But I could have been a developer or an investor, one who put millions of pounds into this borough, and I could have left the borough. So we need to put ourselves in the shoes of the customer. We've got to deliver, beyond no doubt, we have to deliver the local plan by November. That is a hard and fast deadline. And failure to do that will cause us significant difficulties. In MHLG, just last week, met the Chief Planning Officer, so we've been corresponding for quite a while over the local plan. He said to me, we didn't think you could do it. I didn't think you could do it. I said, I didn't think that I could do it. But somehow we've got to this point where we're quite close now to the Reg 18 consultation. We'll be coming to full council shortly. And actually, because of burden, we've lost 4 weeks, we've built enough time in through the work we've done through the summer that actually we've got that space. We have to get the local plan to examination by November. We need to increase our role and profile in the city region. The city region will increasingly play a more vital and important part in what we do, and we need to be in there playing at that table because there's a lot of money there, we have to bid for it, and they're really interested in some of the stuff we're doing around the regeneration and growth agenda. That opens doors to Homes England. We have one of the largest Scranfield sites in the North West. We've never been talking to Homes England before. So was it in doubt that we're going to deliver our local plan? We're now in a massive conversation with them about the opportunity for regen and growth. There are real green shoots in the borough. And as you know, we come out of intervention on children's, so we need to continue to radically improve children's services, because it is all about the next generations. And don't underestimate that opportunity that we have to shape that. So what am I doing? So we're resetting the leadership team. So we are no longer working in silos. When I first started, it was just at the tail end of the previous DCS. We came to the senior leadership team meeting, walked in, told us where we were, then walked out again. And everybody breathed a sigh of relief. Thank goodness that's not my directorate. Thank goodness that's somebody else. The local plan is not our NEM's problem, it's not my problem. The budget is not Cher's problem. These are collective issues that we need to resolve together. And I think we're beginning to get there. Be more visible and more accountable. Hopefully most of you know me by now. You kind of do see me out and about. Just come off the back of running six staff road shows. We saw over 1,000 people. People left the early ones and went back to their team and said, the chief exec's talking, he's saying some really good things, and the group got bigger and bigger, more and more people. And SLT are out and about more, they should be engaging with you more, and that's really important. But I need to lead this from the front. But accountability is key. It may surprise you that for the first time this month, we've just had the first round of quarterly performance reviews with directors. This is around their director performance, where we look at their financial performance, their HR performance, how they're doing against audit, how they're doing against risk, how they're doing against health and safety. Not talking about their individual performance, but how the directors are performing. So if we're in an overspending position, Cher and I will challenge directors early on, so we try and avoid the situation that we find ourselves in when we get to quarter one, avoiding the budget deficit. Some of those things you thought may have been put in place, we're already just putting in place now. Never say anything is not our problem. We'll not pass by that mattress on the side of the road. I can give you some other examples of it, but the mattress is a really good one. It's going to go down in, I think, in myth history here. As I say, manage the council based on detailed performance analysis. We've designed the basic design of the organisation, new organisation structure we talked about. This is about taking some numbers out of the organisation. So my post behind me has been deleted. We're looking at how we create a more efficient and effective structure, more lean. So five tiers of management. No longer will we have strategic directors and all those other director titles we have. So chief executive, executive director, assistant director, head of service, senior manager. So we reduce the levels of spans of control, and there's a clear hierarchy in the organisation. We have some massive challenges this next year, and I think this year's been really hard when I look at some of the things we had at the start of the year. We have turned adversity into an opportunity. I think, you know, if we hadn't reacted to the local plan, I wouldn't be stood here now. We'd have had commissioners in here. But it only begins, the work just begins now. We have to begin the Reg 18 consultation in January. We would have started it this side of Christmas, but for the general election. The QC's view of the evidence we have is, again, didn't believe we could do what we've done. And that's not down to me, that's down to the hard work of officers. We'll launch the Biocultural Legacy Plan and the 2020 events programme. So we're in very final talks with Tour Britain, with getting the Royal Food Festival back. So there is some really exciting things around the legacy of culture. February, the Rural Growth Company business plan will go to Cabinet, which will then start to see the planning applications coming forward for Birkenhead Commercial District, but not just for Birkenhead, this is for a number of different parts of the borough. Hopefully, we'll agree budget in March, and then at the back end of the local elections, we'll go to Reg 19 consultation with a view to getting the local plan to examination by November. But those are some of the sort of the mundane day-to-day stuff that we need to do. What is it that I want to achieve? Well, I think it's unacceptable the health inequalities we have on the borough, differences in life expectancy. And I think we have a real clear role to actually lead the borough into making significant change in that over the next 5 to 10 years. Thank you.